CSNY's summer tour resumed to enormous acclaim in front of packed houses and star-struck audiences, with several performances recorded for a live album, Four Way Street. The shows were also notable, however, for the resumption of the competitive friction between Stills and Young. By the time that the tour wrapped up, relations were at a low ebb. Matters were made exponentially worse by the entry of singer-songwriter Rita Coolidge, who switched her romantic attentions from a tryst with Stephen Stills to a relationship with Graham Nash. The pair came to blows over the affair, and by the end of 1970, America's biggest band was, to all intents and purposes, defunct.
These guys all make music together. These guys should be the happiest people on the face of the earth, you know? They have more than bacon on the table, you know? Why is there bickering? It's not just one of them, it's all of them would find reasons to be disliking something. The worst thing would be like the monitor mixes. Everybody wanted something so different that the monitor person most likely had to go crazy. Because they had to learn, right? Because one person, I want it this way, and, you know? So that was very basic individual power conflict.
Because we had no idea what we were doing. It's not because there's anything wrong with anybody in the band. It's just that what we were confronted with made us be. It changed us. It changed us. The crowd, the adulation, the roaring sound. It changed us. It just.
Four Way Street. While we were recording it, they were starting to have difficulty. When it came time to put it together, when we got the tapes all back to LA, the band was pretty much breaking up and done, and they weren't having a good time with each other. They weren't talking to each other, and I had to do all this editing. And I had to keep it even between Neil and Stephen. And, you know, you got two more bars than I did. And I re-edited that album. I spent 6 months mixing and editing that album to make everybody happy.
I don't think it would have been possible for CSNY in 1970, 71 to go on much beyond that. I mean, a breakup was inevitable. You know, you've got four young guys, two of whom are certainly out of their heads on cocaine. It's petty stuff. But these aren't guys who, they're not very grown up, and they're not very good at talking to each other and resolving stuff and working their way through difficult and apparently intractable dilemmas, you know.
Having gone their separate ways, Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young tended to their various solo projects. Stephen Stills mixed his eponymous debut in LA. Neil Young completed work on After the Gold Rush, and David Crosby recorded up in San Francisco. As the least experienced musician of the quartet, Graham Nash made his first foray into carrying an entire record by himself, with Songs for Beginners, assisted by both Bill Halverson and Fuzzy Samuel.
When we started the first solo album, he was going through a pretty dark period, and the half of the album I did Sleep Song 1, and I did Sleep Song 2, and I did the quieter songs on that album. At one point, I think I remember saying something to the effect of, Graham, this might be a good cure for insomnia. I mean, it was just, and later on, all this energetic songs came later, but it started out to be a pretty dark record, just because he was having a fairly dark time, you know.
Graham would most likely have been, what am I going to do now? CSNY is at this point. You know, him and Stephen was having conflict, and it was pretty dark between them as well. You know, they were falling out a few times for whatever personal things that were going on in their life. So they weren't seeing a lot of each other. So something always came to rub stones that got hot between them.
I am a simple man, and I play a simple tune. Wish that I could see you once again across the room, like the first time. I just want to hold you, I don't want to hold you down. I hear what you're saying and you're spinning my head around, and I can't make it alone.
It was fun to watch him to really come into himself as a singer, songwriter, musician, producer, you know, and get out from under Crosby, Stills, and Young.
The four solo albums released between 1970 and 71 received a massive boost from the success of Deja Vu and the stardust of CSNY. All were high charters. Crosby and Nash's efforts made the top 20, but it was Stills and Young who prospered the most, with After the Gold Rush peaking at number 8, and Stephen Stills reaching as high as number 3.
Not enough credit has ever been given for the solo work, particularly in that period of 1971 to 1972. That's when they, you know, they were coming out with great solo records as well. I mean, Crosby's, if I could only remember my name, is revered. It's a very strange and dazzling record in many ways. I think Stephen Stills' first record, maybe better than Deja Vu. I think it's an incredibly eclectic record. I think it Stills at his best. I really think, as a soloist, as opposed to being part of a group, it's the full flowering of all his talents as an acoustic player, as an electric player. You know, the fact he can hold his own with Clapton on that record and Hendrix.
Having established themselves as viable and popular solo acts, there was no pressing need for CSNY to build bridges and reform the band, despite widespread demand for a successor to Deja Vu. Crosby and Nash, whose close relationship had survived the disintegration of the group, reformed as a duo and went out on a low-key acoustic tour in advance of putting out an album titled simply Graham Nash, David Crosby.
It was a fun record to do. It was a lot quieter, and it didn't have the Stills influence of here's 18 more parts we can put on it. So it's a little sparser. And it's a little more introspective. I mean, it's not, it's just a nice, quieter little piece of business.
They were both on the same page. Graham and Dave were both on the same page, and they brought musicians in who kind of knew what they wanted. So there wasn't a lot of talking about, oh, you gotta play this, you know, we need for you to play this specific part. It's gotta go like this. It was, guys, here we go, here's the song. Let's get something going. The thing I remember a lot about David and Graham is how enthusiastic they were, how much they gave to us in terms of their vibe and their energy. And it was really created an atmosphere where you wanted to be creative and you wanted to give everything you had.
When Crosby and Nash went out as a solo duo, just playing acoustic, I think it was the essence of it. It was the purest stuff I've heard. And I think if Stills had been there, it wouldn't have been as intimate. You got more songs and a bit more variety, but I think the interplay of those two, they had almost a separate career going.
All along the lee shore, shells lie scattered in the sand, winking up like shining eyes at me. From the sea, here is one like sunrise. It's older than you know. It's still just lying there with some careless way.
If you are really into the more Stills Young sort of abrasive, you know, amplified, aggressive side of the CSNY thing, then you're going to find Crosby and Nash a tad insipid, a little wet, I suppose, you know, quite pretty at moments, but it's just a bit twee and a bit insipid.
Stephen Stills, meanwhile, had maintained his ferocious pace, and by the time his debut album was released, he had already begun recording a follow-up. But Stills was having a bad time personally. He remained burned by the loss of Rita Coolidge to Nash and had taken the news of Jimi Hendrix's death hard. He launched his first solo tour in the summer of 71 after the release of Stephen Stills 2, but the tour became infamous for erratic performances and public drunkenness.
He poured himself into a pit. I mean, it's like Jack Daniels. Him and Jack Daniels became a really, really good friend. He would still always be able to perform, you know, but sometimes you could say he could be obnoxious, but drunk. It's not just him personally. He was drunk. He was just drunk.
But when the hangover cleared, Stills found an opportunity waiting. While on tour, he had encountered country rock outfit the Flying Burrito Brothers and struck up a rapport with the Burrito's Chris Hillman, formerly of the Byrds. The pair agreed to meet up for a session with Ron and Howard Albert at Criteria Studios in Florida. With Stills accompanied by band members Dallas Taylor, Fuzzy Samuel, and Joe Lala, and Hillman enlisting Burrito's guitarist Al Perkins, a new project took shape, Manassas.
Me, Joe, and Dallas, we all have a playing thing together. And when Chris and Al came and we started to have a jam, Ron and Howie, obviously, they were just learning to be engineers, captured it, and everybody realized that it sounded like a band.
It was just that, the feeling of a band. You know, I mean, as a musician, I love to play in a band, a whole band. And because it sounded so good when we all played, that's what made me think, you know, this is my favorite band. This is my favorite thing I'm doing, I've ever done.
It's finally gotten to the point where, after all this time, I've been in it 8 years, and Dallas has been with me for four. Fuzzy's been with me too. Chris goes all the way back to the Byrds. Chris got us Buffalo Springfield, our first job. Mm-hmm. It's a question of, okay, fellas, let's get real. Let's do it right and make up for, you know, make up for our mistakes. But number one, show everybody that we can be professional and efficient.
What he's trying to tell you is we have a hell of a band.
Efficient and without losing the magic of the music.
When you say mistakes, are you referring to Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young as part of your mistakes?
Buffalo Springfield, Crosby, Stills and Nash, back and forth, you know, just one after another.
The whole concept was to see what happens with this eclectic group of people. You know, he wanted to have a band. You know, we enjoyed being with each other. We could hang out. And just what happened, a lot of it was created in the studio.
Charged by the sensation of being back in a band, Stills was keen to record instantly. With no songs written in advance, the new group jammed across a panoply of different musical styles, driven onwards by Stills' tireless enthusiasm.
In my opinion, his creativity was at its height.
A lot of country influences, a lot of folk influences, a lot of rock and roll influences, a lot of blues influences. You know, it's kind of like putting together a bunch of incredible musicians and hoping for the best. Well, Stephen's vision played out perfectly. Manassas is one of the greatest records we've ever had the pleasure of being involved in.
We just set it up like we would play a live gig. And just everything started from scratch.